立法會主席.
The President of the Legislative Council. Good morning. Council now resumes. We continue the second debate session of the motion of thanks. The themes are land, housing, transportation, environment, and conservation. Does any member wish to speak? If not, then I would now invite officials to speak, and three officials will speak, and they can spend at most 45 minutes. The Secretary for the Environment.
主席,各位.
Mr. President, good morning, members. I'd like to thank members for your advice. I will speak on climate change, energy, nature conservation, waste management, and environmental quality. Climate change and energy. I'd like to thank members' concerns. This is worth our attention. The community at large should raise its attention to this and take action. The Paris Agreement has marked out clear objectives responding to climate change after 2020, and we will continue our mitigation measures. The CSOA will chair the interdepartmental working group to lead and coordinate the efforts of departments to cope with climate change.
And that is about mitigating and adapting, and also measures to respond to the changes. We have a carbon emission target, and on fuel mix, we're going to increase the fuel efficiency. We're going to promote green road transport and waste management, so there is a multi-pronged approach. We also review our carbon emission scheme and so on, so we could review the latest changes. Now, to respond to climate change is about helping the whole community to understand the problem and to slowly switch to a low-carbon lifestyle. That's why we are going to keep in communication with all the stakeholders. Last year, we reported to the Council the review results of the new scheme of control arrangement with the two power companies. Now, we're going to start discussion with the two power companies. We will certainly bear in mind public interest as we conduct the discussion, including the climate change factor. Conservation of nature, we are going to crack down on illegal ivory trade. That's what we've been doing, actually. On ivory trade ban. Now, this illicit trading of ivory has been a subject of great concern. We're going to start a legislative process soon to spend the export of ivory. We will also consider other suitable measures, including legislating for the ban of import and export of ivory, and eventually banning ivory trade altogether. And we are also going to increase the penalty for illegal trading of endangered species. We also do public education promotion to enhance awareness. In 2013, we started working with reference stakeholders on the biodiversity strategy and action plan, BSAP. We also started a consultation. After we've got the views of the public, we will have regard to the Convention on Biodiversity Principles, and we'll have regard to the situation in Hong Kong. We'll then court priorities, and we will finish our work on preparing the BASAP so we could promote the sustainable development of species. Now, we have various measures to deal with waste management, reduction of waste at source. We have set up an interdepartmental steering committee. So we are preparing for charging for waste. In the 2016 to 17 legislative year, we plan to complete the drafting of the reference legislation. The Environment and Conservation Fund has set aside $50 million to fund community involvement projects. So this will allow the community to gain experience in relation to waste charging. On the producer responsibility scheme, we hope that this council could speed up the scrutiny of the reference bills so that before the end of this term, we could you could pass the two bills on in relation to waste electrical electronic equipment and glass bottles. And then we could implement the schemes on time. I understand that many members have expressed support for the schemes. So I hope, therefore, this council will pass the bills in time. We are also making preparation to build the relevant support facilities and recycling facilities. We've also completed a review on charging for construction waste that we hope to submit a legislative proposal within this term to this council so that we could implement, deal with the charging of construction waste and also combat fly tipping. Again, I understand many members express support for such measures. On turning waste to energy, we are going to do three things. First, we're going to build, prepare for the construction of the integrated waste management facilities phase one that will deal with municipal solid waste. And there will be energy for the facilities itself. There may be a surplus energy to for use for other purposes. We plan to commission the facilities in 2023. And also for the organic waste recycling center, we plan to commission it next year. That's the second point. Third point, we are going to prepare for the tendering exercise for the second phase of the organic waste treatment facilities. And for the 20, we also, and on the food waste and yard waste plan for Hong Kong 2014 to 2022, we are going to promote the change of habits and behavior so that, we could reduce kitchen food waste at source. In October last year, we have launched the Eat Smarts campaign, so we encourage people not to waste food. And then we also encourage the business sector to donate food that's about to expire to charitable groups. This is to save food and not waste. We also have this program to we also have a co-digestion pilot trial at the Tai Po Sewage Treatment Works. We are going to do a feasibility study, and then we can have a proper action plan to deal with kitchen waste. There is the $1.1 billion recycling fund that will help the sector to expand its market and also create more products. There are also small items so that SMEs could apply for the funding as well. And we are doing the tender exercise for free contracts. We're also going to promote clean recycling. And at the community level, we are going to promote the sorting of recyclable materials at source and revitalization of landfill sites. For recovered landfill sites, we will speed up the use so the SWATS bodies and so on could make use of site. And there is a deadline for application of the scheme, which is end of April this year. As for waste management facilities already in service or under planning, while they may not meet in the solid waste to be generated in the coming years, we have started a consultancy, a planning study on waste management facilities. We'll review the facilities and technology required for handling waste so that Hong Kong's needs could be met up to 2041. Air quality. The government has already stepped up its effort to improve air quality. Compared to 2010, in 2015, air quality has notably improved. Carbon dioxide, nitrogen oxides, and respirable suspended particulates have dropped between 10, 12, and 25%. But for ozone level, it's because of regional air pollution that is still on the increase. So we need to strengthen regional cooperation. We are now working with the Guangdong government to look at the how we've been faring in achieving the targets for the Pearl River Delta region emission reduction targets. And then on also related air quality issues, we're going to conduct studies. In 2014, there are 12 air quality objectives for six of them. We have already met the ultimate target of WHO. The others are the interim target. And every 5 years, we're going to review air quality objectives once. And then we're going to start our first review this year. This is a complex and challenging task because it's about considering the health impact on people. We have to consider feasible technologies and other social and economic factors. We are now drafting a work plan. In March this year, we're going to submit the reference proposal to the Environmental Affairs Panel on promoting the use of electric vehicles. Electric vehicles help to improve roadside pollution, also helps to counter climate change. It's also more energy efficient than conventional vehicles. It will help to reduce greenhouse gas emission. So we have offered concessions on the first registration tax. We're also working with various parties to expand the scope of charging facilities, the network of charging facilities. Compared to private vehicles, if public transport vehicles switch to electric vehicles, that would help much more to reduce, to improve air quality. So the bus companies are now testing certain electrical vehicles, and having regard to the affordability of passengers, we will encourage bus companies to promote the use of electric buses. And if there is suitable technology for electric double-deckers, we will also adopt the technology. Now, in 2010, there were less than 100 vehicles, but now there are 4,000 vehicles. The government will provide more medium chargers at government car parks. We are now reviewing the usage of public charging network. We'll also help property management companies to provide charging facilities so that we could promote wider use of electric vehicles. The government members have expressed concern about the pilot green transport fund, which we've set up to promote the testing of electric vehicles, hybrid vehicles, and other new green technology. Victoria Harbour, water quality. In the past 6 years, we continue to press on with the Harbour Area Treatment Scheme. Stage 2A of HEDS has been fully commissioned in December 2015, also which now within the Victoria Harbour catchment is now treated at Stonecutters Island Sewage Treatment Works. For E. coli level and chemical oxygen demand, we can see that this have dropped significantly by 74%, 20% in Victoria Harbour. But then there are other residual pollutants in Victoria Harbour which even cause a odour problem. So the government has commissioned a consultant to try to identify the source of such pollution. And then we could take targeted measures. And for known pollution problems, we will take immediate action. In Kowloon and Xinhuang, we're going to have a dry weather interceptor, dry weather flow interceptors, so we could improve water quality by the shore. External lighting. We have launched the first ever charter on external lighting in January this year. So lighting installation, decorative, promotional, or advertising purposes affecting the outdoor environment, signatories to the charter will agree to switch off the light from 11 p.m. to 7 a.m. There are now exemption arrangements. Over 2,000 properties and shops have agreed to sign the charter. The charter will come into force in April. We will continue to monitor the effectiveness of the charter. In summary, we hope members will continue to support our work in improving the environment and facing the various challenges. Thank you.
Secretary of Transport and Housing. Mr. President, in this session, members spoken on housing. This is the most important issue in relation to livelihood and also the top priority of this term of government. There is imbalance in demand and supply, high rents and high prices stay out of affordability of our citizens. It's a complicated issue. To deal with the root of the problem, we have to face up to the current situation. The reality is that demand outstrips supply. Growth in household is higher than growth in population. And also young people want to improve their living conditions. The middle-income families want to buy their own homes. The answer is to build more homes quickly and increase supply. There is no shortcut. In December 2014, the administration announced its long-term housing policy, LTHS. It adopts a flexible approach and is supply-led. The government's demand determined to find land to provide more land supply. It will relaunch HOS and provide subsidized housing, for example, the Green Form Priority Scheme. Last year, according to the latest estimate, the total target is 460,000 units. The private to public sector, public sector to private sector ratio is 60-40, and for public housing, 280,000, including 200,000 public housing and the rest HOS. This is an aggressive housing supply target. It's a challenge to the community at large. Apart from the determination of the administration, there's need to deal with the inadequacy of land supply, the time-consuming planning process, rising costs, and also labor shortage. In planning for public housing, we face more difficulties and hurdles than expected. Most of the land available are not firm sites. They need to go through planning process, and they have to deal with objections in the localities. And some projects also face judicial challenge. We know that rezoning, increasing density to provide more public housing may cause a certain degree of impact on the neighboring communities. We will do suitable planning and we'll find a suitable balance among different interests. But I do want to urge the community at large to consider the long-term needs of the community at large and adopt an open attitude towards land use planning. We cannot underestimate the demand for public housing, because having a public housing unit is one way of getting out of poverty by many families, and it will help to reduce social conflicts. In achieving this social target, we should not allowed, we should adopt the attitude of one unit less is not acceptable. Now, the fund has been accumulated to $74 billion. It can finance large-scale public housing building projects. We are able to achieve gradual progress in the provision of public housing, but the building, the production rate and quantity is still lagging behind demand. As for application for public housing, the number is increasing. For those on the general waiting list, that is the families and elderly, the number increased from 106,100 to 147,100. And as for application by singleton elderly, the number rose from 93,000 to 143,000. In other words, in 3.5 years, the increase is 53.7%. As for those on the general waiting list, the average waiting time for first allocation is more than 3 years, which is target. Last year, December, it was 3.7 years. I understand that while waiting, people are anxious while waiting for the allocation of flats, but we will still adhere to the average waiting time for first-time allocation to 3 years. This will enable the departments to find more sites for production of public housing. As for private housing, with the continuous effort of the government departments, the supply is increasing. In the coming 3 to 4 years, first-hand supply will reach 87,000 units. In the coming 3 years, the many rounds of demand management measures, or so-called house measures, is to deal with the euphoria in the housing market. The property market, despite the significant downward adjustment of rent in the private sector, demand and supply is still out of balance. The administration has no intention to cut or reduce the harsh measures. We will continue to monitor the situation of the property market. Apart from increasing housing supply, we have not neglected the quality of public housing and the living environment of housing estates. The housing department, the housing authority has adopted a sustainable approach, saving energy, saving water consumption, providing more greeneries, and providing more open space. We'll also provide make use of natural lights and natural ventilation. We also enhance the waterworks of and supervision of public housing estates after the lead-in water incident. The basic policy of our transport is reliant on railway transport as a backbone. And we also promote green transport, improve pedestrian environment. And in new towns and new development areas, we'll promote a bicycle-friendly environment. As for traffic and transport infrastructure, there will be two railroads which will commence operation. This will be the Kwun Tong Extension and the South Island Line Eastern portion. Apart from fully going full steam ahead in promoting the slightly island northern side, which has experienced small slippage, we are going to plan for the Cheung Kwan O Lam Tin Tunnel. We'll also promote the Central Kowloon Link. In September 2014, we announced the Railway Development Strategy. The proposal was that until 2030-2031, 7 railway projects would be completed. By then, the railway network will cover nearly 75% of the population or 85% of the job opportunities. Now, railway is the backbone, but we cannot underestimate other means of public, the contribution of other means of public transport. The administration has no intention to conduct a fourth comprehensive transport study, but with the completion of the railway blueprint, we will conduct a comprehensive study on different means of public transport to enhance their positioning and enhance their complementary roles. Citizens will enjoy speedy service as a wider choice, and the operators can maintain long-term development. Public transport, including the fare level of the MTRCL, should take into account cost of operation, affordability, and continuity of operation. Under the rational arrangement of public transport, we are considering the provision of quality taxis and also increasing the seats of PLBs. We will help the trade to improve their service. We'll also enhance the supervision of hire car service, including the entrance of quality service. We adopt a multi-pronged approach to deal with traffic congestion. We have adopted, in principle, 12 short, medium, long-term proposals of the Transport Advisory Committee, and we will implement those in phases. As for ERP pilot scheme, in December, we started public consultation. We will continue to conduct route rationalization of buses, and we will consider give priority to the demand, parking demand for business vehicles. Now, after the Eastern Harbor Crossing is returned to the government in August, we'll consider the overall strategy of operation among the three tunnels. There are many stakeholders in traffic and transport. There are traffic owners, there are car owners, vehicle owners, drivers and pedestrians, and many other stakeholders. We try to carefully find a suitable balance, taking into account the interests of different parties. As for barrier-free policy, we give priority to enhancing barrier-free facilities in public places, and we are going to implement the remaining 180 projects. In the fourth quarter, we'll invite the district councils to select no more than 3 pedestrian walkways to incorporate them into the scheme to facilitate elderly and the disabled to go up and down ramps, or slopes rather. We will seek funding from the Finance Committee to provide for 3 escalator systems for going uphill slopes. We also consider providing covers to walkways that are linked to public transport interchanges. We also provide funding for real-time displays of bus at bus stops. Traffic and transport infrastructure has to be forward-looking. The development we work with, we are paying attention to the Hong Kong 2030 Plus, and we have started the strategic study on major roads and routes, and that include Lantau, NT-Northeast, and NT-North. Large-scale infrastructure projects in recent years have faced delays and also cost overruns. We will conduct a review on the supervisory system, but we have to point out that last year, the World Economic Forum gave an assessment on competitiveness. Hong Kong's infrastructure comes first. This year, some people criticize large-scale infrastructure projects as white elephants, but the fact is that whether it is the cross-harbor tunnel, the MTR, the new airport, the airport express, and the West Rail, when it was first proposed, people were concerned about waste of public money. But the results are much better, and after they have been completed, they soon working at capacity. Now the third runway, the Hong Kong Macau Zhuhai Bridge, and also other big items, we believe they will enhance Hong Kong's national link and competitiveness. Thank you.
Secretary for Development. Chairman, members, good morning. And I'd like to thank you for your speech on land, housing, transportation, environment, and conservation. And I will talk about the issue of land. Land has always been an important part of our development, providing enough land for our population to sustain our economic development has always been an important part of the administration's work. In the policy address this year, the government reported the progress of the short, medium to long-term progress of land development, and it shows the current administration's commitment. And we are gradually overturning the imbalance between supply and demand, and we are meeting needs for the coming decades. And due to the economic uncertainties, land development has slowed down. And that's why we see high rents and shortage of land. Since it takes a long time from provision of land to development, the work must begin as soon as possible, and we must be persistent, and our work must not stop due to short-term economic fluctuations. The government must increase the supply of land in order to solve the issue of shortage, and it must continue to plan and develop land and build a reserve of land in order to support Hong Kong's sustainable growth in the future. And as such, we won't see repeats of land shortage in the future. And in the short term, the government does not have a magic wand. We need to conduct the work in a gradual manner. And as we carry out the work, we should not cause negative impacts to our community. And further to the 2013-14 policy address, the government continues to execute the blueprint, and the society at large must strike a balance in order to solve the housing needs, so that those on the PRH waiting list and those living in poor conditions can stand to benefit. And with planning permitted, development density would increase, and the surrounding areas should be developed. Apart from the 42 lots poised to be rezoned, in the subsequent policy address, we identified land lots with potential for development, as well as the as long as the zoning plans can be amended. Within the next 5 years, we can offer most of the lands to develop more than 200,000 units, and 70% are public housing units. As of the end of last year, 46 lands have been rezoned for housing purposes, and 410,000 housing units would be provided, and around half would be public housing units, and the other half remaining private, and another 20 land lots also have been rezoned, and when completed, 33,000 would be housing units will be provided. Around 21,000 will be public units and 11 private units. As mentioned, planning and technical constraints permitting, we would further expand our scope of development, and we can provide an extra 17,000 units. Around more than 90% are PRH units. Apart from increasing land supply for housing, we must continue to provide land for economic development in order to sustain our growth. And starting from 2011, the government has sold 19 land lots to provide a total gross floor area of 760,000 square meters. And in 2015-16, the government will roll out 16 commercial lots to provide 67,000 square meters of space. And the government property agency sold certain space in the CNI tower, and at the same time the government is offering more commercial spaces. And they have identified certain spaces, for example, the Mary Road car park, the Carol Lynn Road government landlord, and it will continue to develop energizing Kowloon East and increase the development intensity at Kai Tak. And in terms of long-term housing, long-term land supply, the government is rolling out development of new development areas and new towns. And for Fanlang, Hong Shui Kiu, and Tong Chong, and Yunnan South, a total of 197,000 units will be provided, and they will be completed in phases before 2023. And in developing new development areas in the new territories, we have to consider brownfields with low economic value. For example, Hong Shui Kiu, 198 hectares of brownfield is involved. And working on the brownfields in Yunnan South is an important scope of work. We have to enhance the infrastructure, and we have to go into discussions with stakeholders. Some brownfields, they have potential for development, but at the same time, they are being put into different uses. It's impossible to vacate all of them for development. The government is studying a more efficient use of land and retain operations at certain brownfields and relocate some of those operations into multi-story buildings. And at the same time, one of our scopes of work is to conduct planning and engineering studies to rezone Area 137 of Cheung Kwan Oh, which is a major, one of the last major landlords in urban areas. We will study the desalination plants as well as the relevant environmental impacts and traffic infrastructure impacts. And how we can maximize the use of the remaining 80 hectares of land for housing or other purposes, the relevant studies can commence by the end of this year or early next year. At the same time, the government is updating the overall planning strategy of Hong Kong and the Hong Kong 2030 plus planning study. And we will adopt a pragmatic and action-based approach as we conduct this study, as we plan for land use in the future. Right now, the baseline studies have basically been completed, and the main planning directions and strategies have been established. Right now, we are establishing a framework for conceptual spaces, and later this year, we will launch public engagement to further optimize planning strategy on a territory basis. As for development in Lantau Island, a few infrastructure projects are under planning or construction, and there's enormous scope for development. Development in Lantau is important to the planning of Hong Kong, and the commission has been established for 2 years, and a number of work has commenced, and recommendations have been put forward on Lantau development. And this covers land use, strategic transport development, leisure and tourism, etc. And in January, a working report has been submitted to the chief executive. You can see that we are not intending to build a lot of major constructions everywhere in Lantau. Long term speaking, we have to see whether we can develop a East Lantau town center. We are conducting public consultation, and we want to take in more views in order to optimize developments in Lantau. We will set up a Lantau development office as soon as possible to promote different scopes of work in Lantau, including studies, planning, and construction. Chairman, the government has retained its investment on basic capital works to enhance Hong Kong's competitive edge in the long run. as we enter peak period for major infrastructures. And the expenditure every year will exceed $70 billion, and a lot of employment opportunities will be provided while promoting capital works. We are keeping tabs on the construction industry. In the last 3 years, tender prices have been increasing, and this has led to a lot of concern from our community, including the government. According to the tender prices provided by ArcSD, the rise is about 22%, similar to the private sector, and the increase in the composite price index was 14%. And according to a study, the construction costs are related to economy and the overall number of projects. And we found that the increases were due to increase in basic costs such as machinery, salaries, and other external factors. It also hinges on contractual and design needs, as well as environmental health and safety legislation. And as such, more manpower and materials are required, and the cost would increase correspondingly. And due to market fluctuations and filibustering at LegCo, a lot of public capital works could not be granted in time. And as such, contractors have to defer the relevant risks on the tender prices. In order to meet the rising construction costs, we will establish a multidisciplinary office to coordinate and manage the cost increases, and different measures will be rolled out. For example, redundant design construction needs would be taken out, and an indicator system will be introduced, and engineering procurement would be streamlined as well. We will roll out these initiatives very soon, and hopefully LegCo and the community at large would support our work to solve the issue of rising engineering costs in Hong Kong. Chairman, the short, medium, and long-term land measures mentioned would help satisfy housing needs and aid Hong Kong's development by making the best use of land and exploring new land supply. We can improve residents' livelihoods and living conditions. However, some people still feel that land use can be satisfied by rolling out a few measures. For example, they feel that developing brownfields would be enough, and there's no need to rezone green belts and GIC land. I think a single solution would not be enough to tackling Hong Kong's land use problems. This is unrealistic. Due to tense supply, we must resort to all means to increase land supply. So that we can provide enough land to Hong Kong in a sustainable manner to meet different needs. The government understands different voices from the community on land use, will continue to step up communication, and will strive to strike a balance, and in a fair and impartial basis, to the best of our abilities, we will answer the needs of residents and stakeholders. But the government does not have a magic wand. We hope that district personnel, stakeholders, and residents can understand and support our work and strike a balance. Chairman, last evening, some members suggested setting up an independent board on building maintenance to avoid bid rigging. This issue had actually been discussed in December last year in a motion debate moved by Mr. Christopher Chung. The government gave an answer, so I won't repeat myself today. Yesterday, Mr. Abraham Shack raised some views on the on bidding issues, and since time is limited, I won't go into that. But I want to say that the government does not have a so-called high bid policy. Mr. Cheuk talked about two lots, one in Chengyi and one in Yunlong, and 9 to 10 bids were submitted, but at the end, the tendering exercise was unsuccessful. Recently, a typo landlord was granted. So is it a case of inconsistency from the government? The answer is no. We have a set of mechanism on land sale, and it was approved by ICAC. And before land sale, we would set up a baseline price, and if the minimum price is not met, we would not sell the land. I mentioned landlords in Chengyi and Yunlong. Despite a range of price evaluation in the market, I can tell you that the bids received are far lower than the minimum price. So you can see that we have been adopting the same criteria in vetting these bids. So that's the end of the second debate session. We now proceed to the third debate session.